This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for this program is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
The history of Memphis is filled with important dates and notable achievements, but there is another side to the history, a darker side. In the 19th century and in the early part of the 20th century, Memphis was a rough place, with its fair share of crime bosses and nefarious enterprises, from opium dens, gambling, to illegal liquor. It is a time that has become a favorite subject of one area historian and author. This is a conversation with Wayne Dowdy.
Wayne, thank you so much for being on the program. In fact, I should tell the people out there that Wayne has been our secret weapon for many years. He's our go-to guy whenever we do things like Memphis Memoirs. One of the things I wanted to start out with today was the one of the most popular series on HBO right now is Boardwalk Empire. But you're here to tell us that basically the stories of crime in Memphis in the latter part of the 19th century and the early part of the 20th century is just as compelling as some of the stories that we've seen on Boardwalk Empire.
Well, Pierre, that's very true. Organized crime really sort of takes root in the city in the early 1880s. In 1883, the Tennessee General Assembly outlawed gambling in the state. And what that led is to illegal enterprises sprouting up in the city around gambling. Mm-hmm. And the city government took sort of the novel approach. They didn't think Memphians wanted this law enforced, so they simply didn't enforce it. instead, what they did is they would fine everybody who was involved in gambling. That mm-hmm. money would go back into the city treasury. Mm-hmm. And they were able to restrict and regulate gambling, keep it in the more disreputable parts of town and not having it bleed over into sort of middle class neighborhoods. And the city treasury improved dramatically. I mean, the city had been bankrupt just a few years before. Mm-hmm. And it really, in the 1880s, that really started to help the city turn their financial picture around, because thousands of dollars were pouring into the city coffers.
Oh, man.
And so no one was terribly upset by this. I mean, there were some reformers who had a problem with this, but it really, it was sort of a win-win situation from the city's point of view. And although it did lead to about $40,000 disappearing in about 1885 from the city treasury because there were very sloppy accounting practices, Memphis had never had so much money coming into the treasury.
They didn't know what to do.
Exactly.
Now, the narcotic of choice in the latter part of the 19th mm-hmm. century was opium.
That's correct.
And there's an interesting story. I think one of the first situations that I read about was that it was in the back of a Chinese laundry.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, Henry Ying's Chinese laundry on Main Street. There were several Chinese laundries in Memphis in the late 19th century, which is surprising, and given where Memphis is located. But one afternoon, a police officer who was patrolling the area saw two young women and three young men going into the laundry. Mm-hmm. And they went in, and of course that's not necessarily an unusual thing, although five people going in at the same time is a little strange. Mm-hmm. And so he watches for a while. They never come out. And so after a while he goes in and says, where are those people that came in here earlier? And they said some sort of, cock and bull story. And so he wants to see in the back. So he goes into the back, and there is a room back there, and they are all spread out on pillows and blankets and smoking opium.
Yeah, you see pictures of that. There's pictures of how people were just completely out of it. So
exactly.
A photographer could come in, shoot a picture, and nobody would even
know. Exactly.
The other thing, too, is that for that policeman, mm-hmm. it should be emphasized that there was practically a policeman on every corner.
That's right. So, I mean, he arrests them, but there's no charge because it's not illegal.
There's no law.
No, there's no law against opium smoking in at that time. Later mm-hmm. on in the early 20th century, the federal government actually makes it illegal. Mm-hmm. And there was a huge opium ring on Horn Lake Road that was broken up in 1931 with the police department and the Federal Narcotics Office together investigating this and arresting a guy. The leader of it, a Dr. Rogers, was arrested and sentenced to 8 years in jail for in the federal pen for violating the anti-opium statute.
Wow.
And so, yeah, I mean, these are the good old days, right?
You never think that. Well, you have a certain, I was thinking about this today, you have this certain view of Memphis of grandmas putting their their apple pies out on the windowsill,
exactly.
You know, and you don't really think about this kind
exactly.
of stuff going on.
Exactly.
You played a kind of a forensic historian on one particular case where there was a woman who had died in, I think, an opium den?
That's correct. A customer came into the library and was doing genealogy research, doing family history, and was looking for a great-great-grandmother who had died in the late 19th century, actually early 20th century, I should say. And we go to the death certificate, and we pull it and help her make a copy. And it says opium den where she died. It says died of an opium overdose. And it gives an address, a street, a residence off of Main Street. So we go to the city directories. We're kind of curious about where is this place? Was this her home? Was it, you know, somewhere else? So we look, and it said it was a vacant property. So someone had set up shop in this. And that was the thing that was most distressing to some people, is these were not necessarily the poor who were smoking opium. Obviously, there were some who were, but there was a lot of middle-class white people, women and men, who were throwing their lives away, using this very addictive narcotic, this drug.
Was it cheap?
It was very inexpensive. So was cocaine, which was another thing, and in 1900, the police department, for example, sends a report to the mayor and said, we cannot control the amount of cocaine that is being used in this city. So cocaine, opium, all of these things that we think of as sort of more modern day, particularly cocaine. But in the late 1900, I mean, it was an epidemic in the city.
Well, when do we become aware of the first big crime boss, somebody that we could call a don?
Well, there would have been several in the city. George Honan controlled all gambling interests north of Main Street.
What year was this?
This would have been late 1890s through about 1920 or so. And Honan was involved in a very notorious affair in 1904 when he and some fellow gangsters broke into a gambling den on DeSoto Street. And the city was trying to close these things down.
Right.
And there had been, from 1883 until 1904, there had been this growing sentiment among some people in the city that we need to do something about this crime and gambling in particular. And so a magistrate issued an order to close this establishment. And he sends some of his deputies to DeSoto Street to arrest whoever is there. So they burst in, and there's a bunch of people sitting there gambling. And so they order them, everybody get up, you're arrested. And they line them up, and they're starting to tie them with rope when Honan and some other gangsters burst in. And when they refuse to untie them, they just start opening fire and kill two deputies. And Honan was very close to the mayor at the time, J.J. Williams. This was a huge scandal. Honan was brought to trial, was indicted for murder, but was acquitted. Very quickly.
When you refer to the rackets, of those times, what kind of services were they providing aside from gambling? I mean, did they get into narcotics?
They got into narcotics, yes. They also, owning saloons, of course, providing liquor for customers, prostitution as well. Prostitution was a major industry in the city. Talk about criminal bosses. One of the most interesting and notorious was a man named Mike Shanley, who he actually killed a boss named Ed Ryan in a gunfight and then took over his territory. And he opened a saloon on Main Street. And one day he hears about there's going to be a hot air balloon in Montgomery Park, which is now the fairgrounds. Uh-huh. And so he gets on the streetcar, goes to Montgomery Park, and while he's there, he's watching this balloon, and he takes out a cigar, and he lights it, and he starts smoking, and some official comes up to him and says, "Hey, put that out." Well, he's furious at this. He gets back on the streetcar, goes back to the saloon, grabs a shotgun, and a couple of his friends, they get back on the streetcar, go to Montgomery Park, and they shoot the balloon down out of the sky. Nobody was going to tell him where he could smoke his cigar.
That's incredible. Now when you... some of the other names that I ran into when I was doing downtown, Bellamini was one of them.
John Bellamini, he was actually involved in narcotics as well as did some time in the federal pen on a narcotics charge. He was also a major bootlegger, maybe the biggest bootlegger in Memphis during Prohibition. And remember that Prohibition for Memphis and the state of Tennessee starts a full 10 years before national prohibition. The state of Tennessee in 1909 actually makes it illegal to sell and manufacture liquor in the state. Hmm. And actually it lasts several years after until 1939. So, I mean, there's this long period of time where prohibition, where liquor is illegal in Memphis. Mm-hmm. But, of course, it's not enforced for the mm-hmm. most part. And but Bellamini owned that. He owned a store at 4th and Butler Street and in downtown. And that's where he did a lot of his selling of his illegal liquor.
The story that comes to mind about Bellamini is that the police raided one of his establishments, and out of that comes a ledger.
That's right. They find... it was police and prohibition agents, and they find this ledger book, and they open it up, and at the top of it, written in Italian, is the word law. And below that are names of police officers, sheriff's deputies, mm-hmm. constables, law enforcement officials throughout the county, and next to their names are dollar amounts, $10, $5, $25. And this is presented to... the police commissioner and to the mayor, and the word, of course, quickly spreads across the city. People are outraged at this. What it looks like is a list of bribes, right? Which it may very well have been. The mayor at the time, Rylett Payne, tried to prosecute the police officers, but under civil service rules at the time, all they could do was bring a charge of inefficiency, and there wasn't enough evidence to try them in criminal court for bribery because they could find no witness who would corroborate the ledger book. And of course, the defense says that this is all a mistake, or that, and then they go on and say, well, you know, it looks to us like it's a forgery. You know, this is, they're collecting this, they're right. keeping this so that we can have something on law enforcement, whatever, you know. And they are brought to trial in civil service, in a civil service trial board, but they were all acquitted. And actually, the actions of Mayor Payne led to his defeat in the municipal election of 1927, and his opponent, Watkins Overton, who was the candidate of the organization led by E.H. Crump, becomes mayor.
Well, now, what happened to Bellamini as a result?
Bellamini is, during the raid, they also found some liquor in the grocery store.
Right.
And so he was arrested and brought up on a liquor charge and was sentenced to 6 months in the federal penitentiary in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. So he leaves Memphis. He comes back. He's eventually shot by his girlfriend and dies. So, yeah.
Yeah, he meets a bad end there.
Indeed.
And then we come to Nolo Grande. Interesting thing about Nolo Grande is this was a name from the distant past. And when I was doing downtown, I thought to myself, this is interesting. I wish I could have talked to somebody who was related to Nolo Grande. And suddenly the phone rings one day, and his grandson called me. And described to me a man who was a good family man, a fine family man, spoke still with a thick Italian accent. Mm-hmm. but was nobody's fool by mm-hmm. by any stretch of the imagination. What do we know about Nolo Grande?
Well, he operated the Red Onion Inn, which was mm-hmm. which was basically a saloon. It was a liquor establishment, and even though it was illegal to have those, right, but mm-hmm. but it's not enforced for the most part. But his real success comes with in the numbers racket in what is called policy, which is a lottery. An illegal lottery. You would plunk down 10 cents or 50 cents on a number, and then if your number came up, then you'd win the pot. I mean, he had numbers runners all over the city, even one that went in and collected bets at the Central Police Station every day. Mm-hmm. He would go into the lobby and collect the bets from whoever was there, whoever wanted to buy a ticket.
And again, you're an historian, so mm-hmm. you have to double and triple check this.
Right.
But the story I heard, and again, this is from Nolo Grande's mm-hmm. Grandson. He told me that Al Capone's organization mm-hmm. Had heard about the success that was going on with Grande, mm-hmm. so they decide that they're going to come down and take over Memphis. This was the family legend, mm-hmm. you know. This is the hearsay that I heard, and. What apparently happened, and this is a great movie scene, and I hope it's true,
right.
is that Nolo Grande stands on the bridge and says to the guys from Chicago, "You no touch a Memphis," he says. And apparently the Capone organization backed down. Now, we have no way of checking that out and finding out if it happened that way, but it certainly is a great story.
It is.
I hope it is true.
Yeah, I hope it is too.
You've also written a book about Ed Crump called Mayor Crump Don't Like mm-hmm. It. And would it be correct to say that Mayor Crump had tolerated a certain amount of vice in the city up until a certain point?
He did. I mean, when he first came to power, he was elected to the Fire and Police Commission, and he immediately, in his first meeting, said, "I want all saloons closed in Memphis," and the police department reluctantly did that for a brief time. Then he said, "I want gambling. I want all the gambling establishments closed," and the chief of police said, "There's no gambling in Memphis." And he said, "Oh, yeah?" That night, he gathered a bunch of hand-picked detectives mm-hmm. and a commercial appeal reporter, and they went on a raid and broke up all these gambling establishments, and he came back and said, "Oh, there's no gambling in Memphis, huh?" Uh-huh. So he starts out as a reformer to clean up the
right.
city, but when he's elected mayor in 1909, the saloon interest, the underworld, has a lot of political power. They control a certain number of votes. Mm-hmm. And so it becomes easier to deal with them and reach an agreement with them, an accommodation with them, than it is to try to shut every place down. When he first becomes mayor, he does do a big law enforcement drive, and they close down and they increase the number of fines and tickets that are issued in the city for gambling and prostitution and so on. But after a nice show, mm-hmm. You know, he reaches an agreement essentially with them and leaves them alone for mm-hmm. the most part. And there's evidence in his papers that in one case, people are writing to him saying, you know, this notorious saloon actually of George Honan's, mm-hmm. you know, is two doors down from us, and we want it closed down. It's outrageous. It's loud. People are drunk, you know, and all this, but they leave it open. It is not closed down. So reaching an accommodation with them is just political expediency. And but in the 1930s, in 1935, Collier's Magazine does this expose on crime in the South,
yeah,
called Sinners in Dixie.
Yeah, they paint a pretty bad picture, don't
they? They do, and they particularly blame the Crump organization. They say in the article that he benefits financially from from his arrangement with the underworld.
What was the reaction of the Crump administration?
They were apoplectic. I mean, my uh-huh. God, I mean, this is the equivalent of something like CNN or CBS News doing an expose, uh-huh. doing a
yeah.
special on this. And, you know, this is a mass market, nationally known magazine. So they are furious, and they start a major law enforcement drive, the biggest that the city had ever seen up to that point. And they target Nolo Grande. And to close down the policy racket, because it's the easiest one to close down, because everybody knows where to buy a lottery ticket, where to buy policy. Mm-hmm. And the fact that they're going into the police department every day tells you something about they know where this is. So they shut it down. And usually the way it would work, you would have a drive, as they would call it, uh-huh. and you'd clamp the lid down, and you'd keep it clamped for a week, 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks, until the public became interested in something else, and then you would quietly reopen. Mm-hmm. Well, weeks passed, the police remain very vigilant and continue to harass the numbers runners and everything and pick them up and arrest them as they continue to try to continue their racket. Mm-hmm. But but they refuse. And so Grandi asked to meet with the mayor and the police commissioner, which they do. Mm-hmm. And he says, look, you got to ease up. You're killing me here. And they said, sorry, policy is dead in Memphis. And it is dead in Memphis. It simply disappears. And Grandi is forced to move into DeSoto County and reopen his
policy.
That's
what you told me. Yeah. It would have sounded as if that was he was finished at that
right.
point, but he kept it going.
He kept it going, but just moved out of the city limits of Memphis.
It was interesting because the Grandi family, descendants mm-hmm. of the Grandi mm-hmm. family, still live in DeSoto County. Yeah. About Crump, you've written Mayor Crump don't like it. Mm-hmm. Give us an idea that we can talk about the bad side of mm-hmm. Mr. Crump, mm-hmm. but we can also talk about what he did for the city. If we shot it up to 30,000 mm-hmm. feet and just look at what he did right for Memphis, give me an example, because he ran as a progressive, didn't he?
He did run as a progressive and was a progressive. Some have said that was just a mask he put on to try to get power, and once he did, he discarded it. Mm-hmm. But I don't think that's true. I think he was committed very much to the regulation of business, government regulation of business, believed very strongly in the public ownership of utilities, and believed that government had a role in people's lives, mm-hmm. and very much a Democrat of his day. And, when he comes to power in the city, the telephone service is terrible, mm-hmm. The streets are dirty, the utility rates are sky high, mm-hmm. and when he leaves office first in 1916, then of course he remains a political force in the city, elected to the county trustee's office, elected to Congress in the mm-hmm. early 30s. Until his death in 54, he remains the leader in the city. The city is much better. The city is a quiet, progressive town, clean. Crime disappears from the city, or at least organized crime does, mm-hmm. and it's a good, quiet town. And I think a lot of that gets obscured. And the other thing that I think really gets obscured with Crump is he really believed in sort of political inclusion. Mm-hmm. I mean, he wanted everybody involved in. He wanted everybody's vote,
yeah.
and he gave something to everybody, and that included African Americans who were, marginalized in most. Cities, south and north. Mm-hmm. In most parts of the south, they couldn't even vote, but in Memphis, they could vote. And they had, independent of Crump, developed the strategy of block voting, where they would go to white candidates and say, what are you going to give us? Mm-hmm. We want this. We want streets. We want street cleans. We want better schools, whatever. And Crump was the one who always delivered on those promises.
Well, certainly we could devote a whole show talking about Mayor
right.
Crump. Funny story here, before Wayne came, when we were talking on the phone, and talking about you coming on the show, mm-hmm. I said, do me a favor, Wayne, find a story that will completely surprise us, that is really off the beaten path. And when you came in today, you said to me, the Boy Scout and the German Spies. This is a great story.
Well, in the spring of 1917 in Memphis, there was a young man, a Boy Scout, he's about 13 years old, who was fascinated with radios and new technologies, kind of like the internet of the day. And he had built a crystal set. He studied all the books that he could get his hands on about radio and about radio codes. Remember, there are no broadcast stations at this time. You really wouldn't hear human voices most of the time. What you hear was code. You hear Morse code, or you hear a railroad code, or a ship-to-shore code, or something like that. And so at night, he would fiddle with this and just listen to the dots and dashes and the beeps that he would hear. Well, one night, he hears a code that he's not familiar with. It's not in a book anywhere that he's seen. And so he starts to patrol the streets of Memphis looking for where this is located. He thinks it's in town. It's a strong signal. And he eventually finds it on Jefferson Avenue. And he goes to his scoutmaster's house and he says, you know, I found out where this broadcast is. And you know what? I bet it's a bunch of German spies in there. And his scoutmaster's like, But his scoutmaster was an attorney and knew some folks in the Justice Department, so who had an office in Memphis. So he calls him up and says, look, I'm sure there's nothing to this, but I'm just passing on this information. So they go to visit and essentially raid the building and find German subjects in there, propaganda pamphlets, ammunition, and a very sophisticated wireless radio. And so this young man, Charles Wales was his name, busted up a German spy ring in Memphis in 1917.
And was presented with an American flag from Woodrow Wilson.
From Woodrow Wilson, that's
you
right.
You can't stop, you can't top that. That's a Steven Spielberg film right there.
Indeed.
Thank you so much for being on the program, Wayne. It's been wonderful as usual.
Thank you.